Audible Inc. presents None of Us is as Good as All of Us, How McDonald's Prospers by Embracing Inclusion and Diversity. Written by Patricia Sowell Harris. Narrated by Reay Kaplan. Foreword. McDonald's has an unwavering commitment to inclusion and diversity in our workforce, among our franchisees and with our suppliers, in the United States and everywhere else in the world where we do business. I'm proud that our company values diversity so highly, and I am delighted that Pat Harris has taken on the task of sharing the evolution of diversity at McDonald's because it is a story that all of us can take to heart and learn from. The first lesson that struck me in our story is that the road to becoming a diverse company is not a straight one. There are many bumps and potholes to negotiate and twists and turns that can, and sometimes do, take you off the right path. Like anyone, we have had our share of barriers and obstacles, but we have learned to keep our eye on the goal and persist through the hard times. We have also learned that diversity is a sound business strategy, the smart thing to do if you wish to serve a diverse customer base. Frankly, there is nothing wrong with combining altruism with a very practical approach to diversity. And for those who say that it is easier to embrace diversity when you are the biggest and best in your industry, I would argue that the cause and effect is just the opposite. I believe that our diversity strategies are among the business practices that have helped us to become the acknowledged leader of the quick service restaurant industry. And finally, as Pat makes clear in these pages, inclusion and diversity are not a destination you reach, they are a journey you take. There might be many milestones you pass along the way to mark your progress, but the real benefits come from a constant effort to do things better tomorrow than you do them today. You might achieve diversity goals from a numbers standpoint but still miss the mark, because the true measurement of your success is how you leverage diversity for the benefit of your business and your people. As McDonald's CEO, I am proud to introduce this audiobook to you, and I do so with a salute to all the women and men within our system who have made such an encouraging and inspirational story possible. Jim Skinner, McDonald's Chief Executive Officer. Message. As a longtime franchisee and member of the McDonald's system, I was delighted to learn that Pat Harris was writing this book on the evolution of diversity within McDonald's. I know from firsthand experience that the opportunities McDonald's has provided to people of all races and ethnic backgrounds have been extraordinary, and that this is a remarkable story well worth sharing with the rest of the world. As the chair of Ronald McDonald House Charities, RMHC, I was even more pleased when Pat told me she has decided to donate all profits from this audiobook to our organization. I am happy to accept this truly generous gesture on behalf of all the children around the world who benefit from RMHC programs. As you might know, RMHC is a public charity founded in 1984 in memory of Reay Kroc, McDonald's founder. In partnership with our local chapters, we have donated more than $460 million to date to programs that improve the lives of children and their families in neighborhoods worldwide. Perhaps our most recognized initiative is our Ronald McDonald House program, which operates throughout the world, providing comfort to families with seriously ill children. The first Ronald McDonald House opened in Philadelphia in 1974, and today there are more than 285 Ronald McDonald Houses in 30 countries. McDonald's commitment to be a good neighbor and contribute to the communities that support our business is based upon the same values and principles that underlie our commitment to diversity. Pat sums it up aptly by using Reay Kroc's own words as the title of this book. None of us is as good as all of us. Linda Dunham, Chair, Ronald McDonald House Charities. Timeline. Key dates in McDonald's diversity history. 1957. June Martino is elected Secretary Treasurer of Franchise Realty Corp., which becomes part of McDonald's Corporation in 1960. 1960. Lillian McMahon becomes the first woman franchisee of a McDonald's restaurant. 1966. June Martino is the second woman allowed on the floor of the NYSE. Queen Elizabeth was the first, when McDonald's stock is listed. 1968. Herman Petty of Chicago becomes McDonald's first African-American restaurant owner. For the first time, women are allowed to work as crew members at company-owned restaurants. 1969. June Martino retires and becomes honorary lifetime member of McDonald's Board of Directors. Bob Beavers joins McDonald's licensing department to recruit African-American franchisees. 1970. The Black McDonald's Operators Association, BMOA, is formed in Chicago, electing Ed Wimp as its president. 1971. Women are introduced to company-owned restaurant management ranks. Henry Garcia becomes first Hispanic franchisee in Los Angeles. 1972. The Chicago BMOA holds its first convention. 1973. McDonald's begins its formal association with Burl Advertising, an African-American marketing firm founded by Tom Burl. 1974. McDonald's begins its annual employee satisfaction commitment surveys. 1975. Ted Tongson becomes first Asian-American franchisee in Paris, Texas. Sandy Brooks named first female regional vice president. 1976. The National Black McDonald's Operators Association, NBMOA, is formed in Philadelphia, electing Ralph Kelly president. 1977. McDonald's Big Brother mentoring program for African American employees is launched at a symposium in Atlanta. The McDonald's Hispanic Operators Association, MHOA, is formed and holds its first official meeting in Albuquerque, New Mexico. 1979. Dr. Ron Brown, an African-American consultant, is retained by McDonald's to assist in our affirmative action programs. Women's career development training classes are launched. 1980. McDonald's hires African-American Mel Hobson to head Affirmative Action Department. 1982. McDonald's creates McJobs program to hire and develop disabled employees. 1984. Bob Beavers becomes first African-American named to McDonald's Board of Directors. Ron Damper becomes McDonald's first national African-American supplier, providing tea to local restaurants. 1985. Franchisee Richard Castro launches the Hispanic American Commitment to Education Resources, HACER, Scholarship Fund. 1986. McDonald's introduces McMasters, a program to recruit older workers. 1988. Women Operators Network, WON, is formed, electing Darlene McKellar as its first president. 1989. McDonald's is one of the founding members of the Women's Food Service Forum. 1990. Terry Savage, nationally renowned financial expert, becomes first woman elected to McDonald's Board of Directors. McDonald's Women's Leadership Network, WLN, for women employees, is formed. 1991. Mike Sewell, a McDonald's crew member with Down syndrome, appears in an inspiring Super Bowl commercial. 1992. Rodney King riots in Los Angeles cause $2 billion in damage, but leave McDonald's restaurants virtually untouched. 1994. McDonald's WON receives the Catalyst Award for advancing women and promoting leadership within the organization. The WLN holds its first national conference for women employees. 1996. Enrique Hernandez, Jr., former chairman and CEO of Intercon Security Systems, is the first Hispanic elected to McDonald's board of directors. 1998, Walter Massey, African-American then-president of Morehouse College, is elected to McDonald's Board of Directors. 1999, National Leadership Council of Franchisees is formally established, including executive committee representation from each owner-operator diversity association. Ed Sanchez is named president of the Latin America Group. Gene Jackson, former CEO of Walmart.com, now president of direct-to-consumer for Nike.com, is elected to McDonald's Board of Directors. 2000. Pat Harris is named to head diversity department, replacing Mel Hobson, who retires. McDonald's is named Fortune magazine's most admired company for social responsibility. 2001. Hispanic Gloria Santona becomes general counsel of McDonald's Corporation. McDonald's USA names Hispanic Henry Gonzalez president of East Division, Hispanic Ralph Alvarez president of Central Division, and African American Don Thompson president of West Division. 2002. African American Bill Lamar becomes head of U.S. marketing for McDonald's USA. Jack Greenberg, McDonald's CEO, is presented the Trailblazer Award by the Women's Food Service Forum. McDonald's launches its first Diversity Best Practice Symposium, sharing its diversity programs with 39 outside corporations. 2003, Jan Fields is named president of McDonald's USA Central Division as Ralph Alvarez becomes U.S. Chief Operating Officer. Reggie Webb, African-American owner-operator, is elected chairman of McDonald's National Leadership Council. African-American John Rogers, founder and CEO of Ariel Capital Management, now Ariel Investments, is elected to McDonald's Board of Directors. The Asian McDonald's Operator Association, AMOA, helps establish the Asian and Pacific Islander American Scholarship Fund, APIASF. Fortune magazine names McDonald's the best place for minorities to work. 2004. McDonald's forms Diversity Advisory Council, headed by Pat Harris, Chief Diversity Officer. Ralph Alvarez becomes president of McDonald's USA. McDonald's enables domestic partners to be eligible for its benefits package. Fortune magazine names McDonald's the best place for minorities to work. 2005. Karen King is named president of McDonald's USA East Division. Mary Dillon becomes McDonald's global chief marketing officer. McDonald's Gay, Lesbian, and Allies Network, MGLAN, Employee Network is established. 2006. McDonald's receives the U.S. EEOC Freedom to Compete Award for its diversity and inclusion initiatives. Ralph Alvarez is named McDonald's president and COO, and Don Thompson becomes president of McDonald's USA. Pat Harris is honored with the National Restaurant Association's Salute to Excellence Award. Sheila Penrose, then president of the Penrose Group, now non-executive chairman of the board, is elected to McDonald's Board of Directors. 2007. McDonald's European Women's Leadership Network holds its first meeting. 2008. Ralph Alvarez is elected to McDonald's Board of Directors. McDonald's Asia Pacific Women's Network holds its first meeting. Susan Arnold, then president of Global Business Units of the Procter & Gamble Company, now on special assignment for the CEO, is elected to McDonald's Board of Directors. J.C. Gonzalez-Mendez is named president, McDonald's Latin America. Jose Armario is promoted to group president, McDonald's Canada and Latin America. 2009. McDonald's selected by Latina Style magazine as one of the top 12 companies of the year, named one of the best companies for Latinas to work for in the United States. 1. Welcome to McDonald's. Welcome to McDonald's. That's a familiar phrase to our customers. They hear it repeated more than 58 million times every day when they enter the Golden Arches in one of our 32,000 restaurants around the world. And that's also the spirit of inclusion we extend to the 1.6 million members of the McDonald's family, be they franchisees, restaurant workers, suppliers, or employees. Our welcome is inclusive and sincere because we know the diversity of our people helps us satisfy the world's most diverse customer base. And that's the McDonald's I'd like to welcome you to as we look at the evolution of inclusion and diversity under the Golden Arches and how our commitment to those principles has contributed to the success of our business. McDonald's has been widely recognized as one of the most successful companies in providing opportunities for a wide diversity of people, from the crew rooms in our restaurants to the boardroom for the corporation. Our commitment to diversity extends beyond our own employees to our franchisees and their employees, and our suppliers and their employees as well. This multifaceted and integrated approach to welcoming people has become an integral part of the McDonald's business model, the so-called secret sauce behind our growth as one of the world's most recognized brands. While diversity at McDonald's is all about the business, our efforts have also resulted in numerous honors from outside organizations, including twice being voted by our peers as the best company for diversity in Fortune magazine. The numbers that people rely upon to make such judgments are strong, as you would expect, even though they reflect a direction rather than a destination. As of January 1, 2009, our McDonald's workforce, from the crew members in our restaurants through our CEO, is comprised of 62% women, 35% Hispanics, 20% African Americans, 5% Asians, and 2% Native Americans. Many of those workers are holding their very first jobs, representing the launching pad for their careers at McDonald's, in the restaurant industry, or in virtually every other walk of life. Small part of the story. But these numbers are only a small part of the story because we moved beyond simply counting heads a long time ago. Today, we are intent upon making heads count. So at McDonald's, our definition of diversity includes a broad mix of different ideas, opinions, backgrounds, and life experiences, in addition to the traditional measures like race and gender. That's how we make diversity an active, living part of our business strategies at McDonald's. Maintaining a diverse and inclusive workforce is certainly the right and proper thing to do, but we have long maintained that it is also the smart thing to do. Any company that hopes to serve a diverse customer base across the United States and around the world must reflect that same diversity in the restaurants where we meet our customers face-to-face and throughout our organization where we design our products and services with the distinct wants and needs of our customers in mind. And our business results reflect the validity of mirroring our customers throughout our system very clearly. McDonald's has grown to include more than 32,000 restaurants in 118 countries around the world, nearly 14,000 of them in the United States alone as of the beginning of 2009. We serve more than 58 million customers every single day around the world. Our annual sales at both franchise and company-owned restaurants amounted to more than $70 billion in 2008. Producing $6.4 billion in operating income. By any yardstick, McDonald's is far and away the market leader in the quick service restaurant category, a segment that we virtually created since we began operations more than 5 decades ago. As McDonald's Global Chief Inclusion and Diversity Officer, I am as proud of our record as any of the 1.6 million people in our global family. But I must also tell you, in all honesty, that it wasn't always this way. Societal attitudes. When we were founded in 1955 by Reay Kroc, McDonald's reflected the attitudes of U.S. society in general. In that post-World War II environment, race and gender equality in the workforce were unheard of and talked about very little. It was very unusual when women, as epitomized by Rosie the Riveter, took on many factory and industrial jobs during the war. But when the war was over, most women moved back into the home and made way for the veterans to return to their jobs. McDonald's itself didn't even allow women to work in our restaurants until the mid-1960s. So, when pent-up societal issues in the United States began to erupt in the 1960s, McDonald's executives, like everyone else in the corporate business world, realized that they had new challenges to face. It has not been a smooth road to get where we are today, and there surely are still bumps to overcome. However, there were several factors that helped McDonald's appreciate the value of diversity that came into play throughout its evolution. I will mention them briefly here because they represent the theme of this historical look at diversity development, and they will come into sharper focus throughout this audiobook. It is my opinion that they are replicable by any other organization that is struggling to embrace diversity today, whether your efforts are just beginning or started earlier and are now stalled or are still on your organizational to-do list. Support from the top. The first essential element is a strong and unwavering commitment to diversity from senior management. Reay Kroc created a unique organization when he started McDonald's in the 1950s, using a business model that seemed downright radical at the time because he set up McDonald's like a three-legged stool, with the legs of the stool representing the franchisees, suppliers, and company. Each leg of the stool had to prosper for the others to succeed, thereby creating a partnership of interests that required the entire system to work together. Kroc used to say, "None of us is as good as all of us." And while it was originally aimed at the way McDonald's three-legged stool had to operate, it was prophetic in the way it came to apply to our diversity efforts as well. Above all else, Kroc was interested in selling hamburgers, and when it became clear to him and to Fred Turner, his right-hand man, that we needed African-American, Hispanic, and Asian entrepreneurs to help sell more hamburgers in minority communities, that was the approach they took. Like everything Kroc and Turner took on, they did so enthusiastically, and McDonald's top management has reflected that commitment through the years. Leadership from the top is critically important in embracing diversity. Training is key. The second important element is training and education. This was also a well-ingrained attribute at McDonald's from the very beginning. We hired so many high school kids that we quickly became America's favorite first job. That meant we had to train our people in basic restaurant operations and, indeed, in fundamental on-the-job behaviors and attitudes to get them up and running. In addition, we needed to train our owner-operators and store managers in advanced restaurant operations, how to run a restaurant the McDonald's way, if you will. And that meant creating Hamburger University, our state-of-the-art training center, as well as regional training centers. So from the early days, McDonald's was a company that understood the value of training and used training to accomplish our business goals. Training became one of the important tools we used to make diversity work at McDonald's Corporation as well. We discovered that bringing people in the front door was the easy part, but without training to develop corporate survival skills, those same people would soon walk out the back door. So we trained our women and minority employees to understand the corporate environment and develop strategies for personal success. We also trained their managers and supervisors so they could learn how to understand and manage a diverse workforce. That's why our diversity training and education continues to this day. It reflects all that we have learned and addresses the barriers that we still need to overcome. Networks are invaluable. Finally, The third element that fosters a diverse workforce is employee networks. Networks are established in our home office and in every region of the country and most of the world to foster relationships and career development opportunities through meetings and seminars that enhance our employees' development and promotional opportunities. We patterned our employee networks after the associations that our minority and women owner-operator members formed to leverage their own interests, like the National Black McDonald's Operators Association, the Women Operators Network, the McDonald's Hispanic Operators Association, and the Asian McDonald's Operators Association. Today, there are employee networks for women, African Americans, Hispanics, Asians, gays and lesbians, young professionals, and working mothers, and they keep our people connected, in touch with potential mentors, and on top of career development opportunities. Management support, training and education, and networks are the three building blocks for an effective diversity initiative in any company, and my own personal career reflects all three of those elements as well. It's how I came to be what I am today. Telling our story. I am the last of 11 children raised in a farming family in McBee, South Carolina, and my aspiration as I was growing up was to be a secretary for a major corporation in New York City. That goal turned out to be a launching pad for where I ultimately wound up. Today, in my role as Vice President and Global Chief Diversity Officer at McDonald's Corporation, I work closely with the company's senior officers. And for some time, I worked every day in the very same office where Reay, the founder of McDonald's, once worked. There isn't a day that goes by without my taking a moment to consider the awesome capability people have to grow into greater responsibilities when they are given a chance. It has been an amazing journey for me and for McDonald's, and that's why I have decided to tell this story. This evolutionary tale of how a little hamburger company grew to be one of the most diverse and inclusive business organizations in the world. It's not only a fascinating history, but I believe others can learn a great deal from McDonald's experience. To tell this story, I have interviewed dozens of people who have been an integral part of McDonald's diversity history, from past senior management to my colleagues today. From pioneering owner-operators to current leaders of our operator networks, from women and minority suppliers for our restaurants to the consultants who helped establish our original training programs. Hear their voices. Our success in building our record of diversity is really the result of the contributions of all our people. That's why you will hear their voices throughout this audiobook. Because I believe it's most credible to tell our story from the perspective of the people who made it all happen. I have also relied upon the accounts of McDonald's early history in some excellent books, including Grinding It Out by Reay himself, Behind the Arches by John Love, McDonald's at 50, which was published by the company in 2005 to commemorate our first 50 years in business, and Standing Up and Standing Out by Roland Jones, one of our pioneer African-American employees and later a successful franchisee. And, of course, I have lived this history personally for the past 3 decades. My part in this story is simple. I am one of literally tens of thousands of people who have been touched by the opportunities that McDonald's provides to its people, whether they are employees, franchisees, or suppliers. This organization has understood from its very beginning that the surest path to success is to provide opportunities to help people reach their own potential, and I am certainly no exception. A farmer's daughter. I was born Patricia Janice Sowell in 1947 in that small South Carolina town of McBee. My father raised watermelons, strawberries, and sweet potatoes, as well as 11 children, 5 girls and 6 boys. I was 14 years old when he died in 1961. My mother was a self-educated woman who didn't even graduate from high school, but she worked as a practical nurse as well as a substitute teacher at the little school in McBee whenever the principal called. I still remember vividly when I was in high school, they hired the first typing teacher my school had ever had and purchased all these great typewriters for the students to practice our skills. I loved to type. I became very good at it, and I remember thinking, wow, I want to be a corporate secretary when I grow up. I even put that in my high school yearbook. For some reason, all my brothers left the farm and moved to Philadelphia when they grew up, and all my sisters moved to New York. As a result, I visited those big cities many times during summer vacations to babysit for their children, my little nieces and nephews, and I had already decided that New York was going to be the place for me. So, when I graduated from high school at the age of 16, I immediately moved to New York and enrolled in Brown's Business School for a year. After working for a couple of different little companies, I landed a job with General Electric Company as a secretary and stayed there for 6 years. On to Chicago. I moved to Chicago in 1976 and initially worked at a job at CNA Insurance Company as a secretary for the senior vice president of human resources, although he left the company just a couple of months after I arrived. After a short stint at a Chicago insurance brokerage firm, I interviewed at McDonald's and got a job as an administrative assistant to Noel Kaplan, one of our corporate attorneys in the legal department. The very process of being hired gave me an immediate insight into McDonald's style of doing business, because Noel interviewed me on a Friday, offered me a job on the spot, and wanted me to start Monday. After I explained that I had to give my current employer time to find a replacement, he said, "Well, okay, give them a week's notice and then you start." All during this time, I had been pursuing a college degree, attending classes part-time at Queensborough College and then York College while I lived and worked in New York, and then at Roosevelt University in Chicago. So when I started work at McDonald's in February of 1976, I thought the job would just be something to tide me over until I got my degree in personnel management a couple of years down the road. But, like many people who are...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.